We will continue with chapter number 8 of science 1, which is called metallurgy, and we will finish the chapter now. Remember, the name of the chapter is metallurgy, which is about extraction of metals. The main steps are mining, concentration of ore, extraction of the metal from its metal compound, and refining. However, the focus of the chapter is only two of the steps, that is concentration of ore and extraction of the ore from its metal compound. But to give a foundation of the process of metallurgy, we revised the physical properties of metals and nonmetals. And then we studied the chemical properties of metals and nonmetals. When we say chemical properties, we understood how to react with various substances like oxygen, water, acids, bases, all those things. We realized that some metals are more reactive, some metals are less reactive. So we got introduced to this series, which is called reactivity series. Okay. One extraction process we studied in a lot of detail, which is the extraction of aluminium from bauxite. All the diagrams in this chapter are important. Some are important from drawing perspective and some are important from knowing perspective. So all the diagrams which are listed in the in a question number 8, I think, to be drawn, please practice them properly. And all other diagrams, they also can be part of the test. But they are highly unlikely that people will ask you to draw them, but the diagram will be given and you will be asked questions about them. So after we have understood what metals are, how they are different from non-metals and where they are found, how we get metals for our use, let us understand the last topic, which is called corrosion, C-O-R-R-O-S-I-O-N. This is not a new thing. This is not something that you are listening for the first time. This is how our session will look like. We will study only about corrosion today. That's the last part of the chapter, last three pages. So it starts on page number 106 and ends on page number 108. And within this, we will divide this topic into three parts. One is definition, where we will understand what is corrosion. Second thing is the reason, where we will understand why it happens. So what and why. And finally, prevention. How can we stop it? Now, the moment we see this heading, prevention, hum nahi chahte ki ye ho. That means this is not a good thing. Yes, you are right. It is not a good thing. So something that happens, corrosion is something that happens, but it is not good. Be ready with your textbooks and notebooks. Be ready with your pencils and pens to annotate and write. Definition. What is corrosion? There are multiple ways of defining corrosion. Let us remember that corrosion sounds very similar to erosion. Erosion that we have studied in geography. Erosion causes the formation of soil from rocks. Erosion causes landslides. Erosion also causes, it may lead to floods. So yes, corrosion is also very similar to erosion, where things break down. Corrosion is not about sand or rocks. Corrosion is about metals. The entire chapter is about metals. Corrosion is about degradation of metals. Degradation means breaking, means wasting of metals. And this doesn't happen suddenly. It's a slow and continuous process. Slow and continuous process. And it happens because of when the metal is exposed to the environment. It's a slow process, it's a continuous process, it is a process in which the metal degrades. Easier word is, the metal wastes, kamzor ho jata hai, khatam ho jata hai, when it comes in contact with the environment. This is a very simple way of explaining what is corrosion. just one line answer. Degradation, wasting, breaking, slow, continue. So why does it happen? When we say it happens when, or it happens due to its exposure coming into contact with environment. So what happens when the metal comes in contact with the environment? We already have studied that metals react with various substances. They do react with oxygen, they do react with water, they do react with other compounds also. Now, when the metals come in contact, when the metals are exposed to air, what is air? Air is an envelope of gases which is around.
Air is gases.
Air is not gases, Rahul. Air is not gases. Air is a mixture of gases which is present around the planet Earth. It contains various gases. Oxygen is not the most abundant gas. Nitrogen is. But when we say air, when we think of air in conjunction with, in the context of corrosion, what we are talking about is these three main components. One is oxygen, second one is water vapor, and there are other gases also. So metals react with these gases. You know that reaction, chemical reactions are not physical changes, they are chemical changes. They are usually one-way street. Ho gaya, ho gaya. So, in a chemical reaction, the reactants, they combine, they react to form new compounds, which are products. So here, when the metal is exposed to oxygen, water vapor, other gases in the air, chemical reaction happens and the metal forms metal compounds. So the metal is there, but its form, the way it exists, that changes. Not just physically, chemically. Because of that, there is a degradation of the metal. There is a wasting of the metal. We all have seen this in real life, all of us. And we have seen this multiple examples, multiple instances. One instance, we have even studied in detail in chapter number 3, chemical reactions and equations, which is rusting of iron. We have seen how when iron is exposed to air, usme jang lag jata, which is called rusting. You also know if this goes on for a long time, it will just break. The strong iron will just break. Another thing that most of us have seen is how utensils or ornaments made up of silver, they become black after some time. This is also corrosion. This is corrosion of silver. Also, statues and maybe other ornaments that may be not ornament, utensils that may we may have of copper. This statue, which is the Statue of Liberty, is not actually green in color. It is made up of copper. It should look reddish orange, but it looks green, grayish. Because here the copper has corroded. Copper has corroded. So even less reactive metals like copper and silver, they also undergo corrosion. And of course, more reactive metals like iron will definitely undergo corrosion. And all this is happening because of the chemical reactions that the metals undergo when they come in contact with different components of air, mainly oxygen, water vapor. So water vapor is H2O, oxygen is O2. And other gases. Now, if we have seen this, what is happening? What is the science behind all this? So, we have studied the first thing, which is called first instance of corrosion, which is corrosion of iron, commonly known as rusting, jang lagna. We have studied this in chapter number 3, where we said iron reacts with water. It gets oxidized into iron oxide. which is reddish brown in color. We have studied this reaction in detail. Iron gets oxidized into ferrous oxide, then it gets oxidized into ferric oxide. That is what is happening. That is why iron gets rusted. Now, copper turning green. Copper reacts with oxygen in the air to produce copper oxide, and the copper oxide then reacts with the carbon dioxide to form copper carbonate. This copper carbonate is greenish in color. Beware. This compound is poisonous. Not just poisonous. Agar hum aise bartan mein khana rakhenge, the food will get stale. Kharab ho jayega. And this process is called patination. The rusting of iron is called, the corrosion of iron is called rusting. The corrosion of copper, which happens with reaction with carbon dioxide, is called patination. P-A-T-I-N-A-T-I-O-N. Patination. Similarly, why did the silver ornaments or silver vessels, why do they get black? Why do they become black? Because that silver reacts with hydrogen sulfide, which is present in the air, to form silver sulfide, which is black in color. Iron reacts with water to form iron oxide. Copper reacts with carbon dioxide to form copper carbonate. Silver reacts with hydrogen sulfide to form silver sulfide. And one more example. Example of the metal that we studied in detail, Hall's method, Baer's method, calcination, electrolytic reduction, the metal aluminium, so reactive that it constantly reacts with oxygen in the air. And because of that, a whitish coating of aluminium oxide is formed on aluminium. It is so thin and it is almost transparent that it is not visible to the naked eye. But this also happens. So let us remember these things, because this is what will be tested this year. Not what is corrosion, because that is old news. That is old. New study is what is happening in the specific cases of corrosion. Corrosion of iron, corrosion of copper, corrosion of silver, and corrosion of aluminum. The way I have presented the information here is very, very, very brief is the summary. And if you are struggling to write in English sentences, this is how we can write the minimum we need to write. But of course, definition should include sentences. If the question comes for just one mark, to ask what is corrosion, you can give a one-line answer. Corrosion is the degradation of the metal when they come in contact with the environment. But if the question is for 3 marks, what is corrosion? So we will say that it is degradation of the metal when they come in contact with the environment. We will say it happens because the metals react with various elements of air, chemical reactions take place, and then we complete the answer with one of these examples. So understand how we need to write the answer to a question depending on the marks that they carry. So if it is 1 mark, just the definition. If it is 3 marks, definition, explanation, and example. So clearly now, degradation is not good. Wasting is not good. Iron becoming iron oxide, the iron material becomes useless. It becomes weak. If copper becomes copper carbonate, the utensil even becomes poisonous. If silver becomes silver sulfide, not only it becomes dull, it is also wasting. Aluminium becoming aluminium oxide, yes, it does not show, but that is also wasting, degrading. So corrosion is not good. It's not good for the life of the metal. It is like a disease of the metals, where they are getting old, weak, and dying. But we need metals, and we need metals to last long. इफ करोजन happens, then आज हमने जो बनाया होगा हो सकता है 2 महीने बाद वो खत्म हो जाए, which is not good. So we need to know how can we prevent corrosion from happening. How we can prevent corrosion from happening. Now the answer to this question as to how we can prevent corrosion from happening comes from our understanding of how it happens. It happens when it comes in contact, metal comes in contact with air, comes in contact with the environment. So the prevention has to be ki we will ensure that it does not come in contact with the air. It's like humko exam mein kam number hai. So what do we do to get more marks? We will study. Nahi padhe, nahi hua. Padhenge, ho jayega. Similarly, if the corrosion is the result of chemical reaction when the metal is coming in contact with the environment, then the prevention should involve isolating the metal from direct contact from air. So we need to cover it. We need to cover it. We need to do something so that the metal does not come in direct contact with air and different components of air. How will we do it? We will apply a layer of something on the metal. For example, to keep our books safe, we cover them. We put cover on the books. We do similar thing to stop or to prevent corrosion. We put a layer of some other thing on the metal. And that other thing, we already know. It can be paint, it can be oil, it can be grease, it can be varnish. Varnish is also like a paint. It is usually maroon in color. You have seen people painting grills. You, those of you who have cycles, you know that the chain of the cycle needs to be oiled and greased from time to time so that it does not rust. So when we do all these things, what we are doing is we are putting a layer between the metal and the environment. We are stopping it from coming into contact with the environment. In Hindi, we say, right? Na rahega baans, na bajegi baansuri. So if there is no contact, then there is no chemical reaction. If there is no chemical reaction, there is no corrosion. But things are not that simple. Paint, oil, grease, varnish, all of them are temporary. All of them are temporary. They also keep wasting. And they can be scratched. Even if a small portion of the paint or the varnish is scratched, the metal will be exposed to the environment and the corrosion will start. And the corrosion will spread. So we need some more permanent solutions. I'm not saying permanent solutions. I'm saying more permanent solution, more long-lasting solutions. And that is the second important part of corrosion that we are going to study this year. The first part was how corrosion is happening in various cases. So iron, copper, silver, aluminium. And the second important part is how do we prevent corrosion? Not just by painting, oiling, greasing, and varnishing, but something else also. 5 different methods are given in your textbook from starting from page number 107. Starting from page number 107. They are galvanization, tinning, anodization, electroplating, and alloy. Galvanization is written as galvanizing in the textbook. Anodization is written with a Z in the textbook, as I always keep telling you. Z is the American spelling, S is the British spelling. We can use either, we can use both. Galvanization, tinning, anodization, electroplating, and alloying. If you want to call galvanization as galvanizing, do it. It's up to you. We need to understand how each of these, what happens in each of these processes and how they help in preventing corrosion of metals. First one is galvanization, and I think this is one of the very bad, not one of the very bad, we can say this is the worst diagram in the textbook, where it's not clear what is happening. We are just taking something and doing something, and some labeling is there. Essentially, what we do is we put a layer of zinc. In this method, we put a layer of zinc on the metal that we want to save, the metal that we want to prevent from corrosion. Usually, galvanization is used, although we can say galvanization is used to prevent corrosion in case of iron and steel. Iron is a metal. Steel is not a metal. Steel is an alloy of iron and carbon. It's a mixture of iron and carbon. When we add carbon to iron, it makes it even more stronger. So if you, where have you seen this galvanization? Every time you look at the Alpin that is used to staple pen papers together, it is very shiny. The new nails, they are shiny. If you see a new bicycle, especially the handle, they are shining. They are shining because of the coating, the layer of zinc on them. So what is done in the process is, we take the metal, that iron or the steel that needs the coating of the iron, and it is dipped in molten zinc. Hum usko dubote hain aur usse nikal dete hain. So the detailed process is given in the form of diagram, that caustic rinsing, then rinsing, dho rahe hain usko, pickling, we soak it for some time, then we again rinse it, we wash it, then we are dipping it in the flux solution, which helps it absorb zinc properly. So we clean it, rinse it, pickle it, rinse it, and then we apply flux on it, then we help it dry, we keep it to dry, and finally we put a coating of zinc on it. Then the dull iron, the dull steel will look very, 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 very shiny. It will reflect. We will be able to see our face in it. Remember here, this zinc, the metal zinc, is more reactive than the metal iron and the alloy steel. And it prevents corrosion of iron and steel because, one, it acts as a cover. It isolates the underlying metal from exposure to the environment. And second, because even if there is a scratch on the surface, even if there is a scratch, because zinc is more reactive than iron and steel, first the zinc corrodes, first the zinc reacts. Only when the zinc is gone, the iron will start corroding. So this is not a permanent solution. Definitely not. But this is a much longer lasting solution than painting or greasing or oiling or varnishing. So what is galvanization? Putting a layer of zinc on iron or steel to prevent its corrosion. How does it work? Zinc is more reactive than iron, so it reacts first. Also, it isolates the metal from the environment. Another method that is given in your textbook is called tinning. The physical nature of galvanization and tinning, they are same. In galvanization, the coating that we are making, the layer of substance that we are putting on the metal is the layer of zinc. In case of tinning, as the name suggests, the substance that we are putting on the metal is tin. And usually, this is carried out on copper. The same copper which reacts with carbon dioxide to form calcium carbonate, which is poisonous. It even spoils the food. The patination can be prevented. The corrosion of copper can be prevented. The formation of copper carbonate can be prevented if we put a layer of tin on copper. Similarly, same method. We need to know these names. So galvanization is about zinc on iron and steel. Tinning is about tin on copper. All these methods of, but one methods that are given to prevent corrosion, they are about isolating the metal, putting a obstruction between the metal and the environment. So in that context, the third method that is given in your textbook is called anodization. Just, it's a new word, but just break it down. Anodization is must have formed with anode, which we know both from physics and chemistry, and the suffix -ization, which makes a noun, name of a process. So anodization is about putting a thin and strong layer of metal oxide on the metal. And this is usually carried out for metals like aluminium and copper. Remember, both aluminium and copper, they do react with oxygen to form their oxides. But that is very temporary, that's very thin, even thinner. That doesn't help prevent the corrosion. But if you do it in a proper way, and that proper way is using electrolysis. And in this electrolysis, the metal that needs to be anodized is kept as anode. It is connected to the negative terminal or positive terminal. It is connected to the positive terminal. It is the anode. Remember, the cations, the positive ions, they move towards the cathode, which is negative. So usually metal is deposited on the cathode, but here we are not depositing metal. We are creating a layer of oxide on the metal. So we need oxidation. Right? And that oxidation happens at anode. You look at any electrolysis, you will see that oxidation happens at anode. Take any electrolysis. So to form metal oxide, we need to carry out oxidation. So we will connect the metals. So in this case, you see these metal plates. They are connected to the anode, that is the positive terminal. So the oxygen from the electrolyte, the negative oxygen ions, the negatively charged ions will move towards the positive terminal, that is anode, and there they will react with the metal to form the metal oxide. And that metal oxide, we can control the thickness of the layer of the metal oxide. So we are corroding it to prevent further corrosion. That layer will isolate the metal from environment and it will prevent further corrosion. Another similar process which uses electrolysis is electroplating. Electroplating is more like the processes of electrolysis that we have studied, where the metal deposits on the cathode. So in electroplating, the metal, the thing that we are trying to prevent corrosion of, it is used as cathode. It is connected to the negative terminal. And we put a layer of another metal on top of it. And that another metal is usually less reactive. Remember galvanization, zinc is more reactive than iron and steel, but here in electroplating, we will try put a metal which is less reactive. So that first the metal is isolated from the environment, there is no corrosion of the metal itself. Also, the metal that is covering the underlying metal, that itself doesn't get corroded. Very common examples are putting a layer of silver on spoons, cutlery. Putting a layer of gold on ornaments. So if you have to put a a layer of silver on spoon. So we will connect the spoon to the negative terminal. So we have made it cathode. We are, and this is made up of aluminium to start with, very cheap. Then we are connecting a silver plate to the cathode, to the anode, not to the anode. So here the silver ions will be produced. They are positively charged. They will move to the negative terminal, which is the cathode, where we have the spoon, and then they will deposit there. And we can control how the deposition happens, how thick. And we will have a shining, very expensive looking spoon, which will not corrode, because silver is less reactive than aluminum. But of course, that will become black. So we will have to clean them. So remember the difference between anodization and electroplating. In anodization, the metal is connected to the anode. Here, in electroplating, the metal that is being protected is connected to the cathode. Main difference. That brings us to the last method of preventing corrosion that is given in the textbook and very commonly used, which is called alloying. Very interesting concept. Alloying means making alloys. So what are alloys? Alloys are mixtures of metals and non-metals. Mixture of a metal with other metals or non-metals. So it is compulsory that there is at least one metal in this mixture. It's not a solid mixture. We melt the metals and non-metals, maybe mix them, and then they are cooled to make solid again. If you read, it says in a fixed proportion. It sounds like a compound, but no, it's not a compound, because the combination is a physical combination. There is no chemical combination here. And because of the presence of other metals, the intensity of the corrosion is reduced. Corrosion band nahi ho jata, but it becomes very, 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 very slow, and it becomes very less effective. We must know some very common alloys. Bronze is a common alloy, which is an alloy of copper and tin. Bronze in Hindi is called kansa. Copper is tamba. Another common alloy is stainless steel, which is very common. We don't know, but it is used in the knives and the blades. It's an alloy of iron, chromium, and carbon. In what proportion? That proportion is given in the textbook. Find out, remember. One more alloy I mentioned when I was explaining to you galvanization, which is steel. Steel is an alloy of iron and carbon. And so bronze is all metal, copper and tin, both are metals. Stainless steel, iron, chromium are metals. Carbon is non-metal. Steel, iron, and carbon. Carbon is non-metal. All of them at least have one metal. Another common example is alloys having mercury. And all of them are called amalgam. So if it is sodium plus mercury, sodium and mercury, it will be called sodium amalgam. That is how the name is created. Now this information is given in a pink box in the textbook with the heading, "Do you know?" So of course, this will not be asked in the exam. Interesting information, good to know. Remember, we are not only studying for the exam, we are studying for life. So let us try to cover as much as possible. And these alloys are also used in the coins that we use. In the olden times, the coins were gold, silver, copper. One of the reason was that then we did not know how to make alloys. Now we know. So it saves us money, it makes the coins stronger, shinier, and it makes the coins cheaper. So the coins that we use in India, they are also alloys, not pure steel, not pure iron. We have answered most of the questions from the exercise. I think only three remain. Let us see what they are and how we can answer them. We have already completed D, C, D, E, and F of question number one. Only one A remains, alloy of sodium plus sodium with mercury. I gave you the name just now. It's called sodium amalgam. So if the question was, what is the alloy of magnesium with mercury? You will say magnesium amalgam. If the question is, what is the alloy of iron with mercury called? It will be iron amalgam, A-M-A-L-G-A-M. Question number two, we have answered completely. Question number three, we have completed. Question number four, we have completed. Question number 5A. Question number five is the most interesting question because it says, write scientific reasons. Karan batao. The why thing. B, C, D, and E, we have already answered. A is the most interesting part, which says lemon or tamarind is used. Lemon is nimbu, tamarind is imli. Is used for cleaning copper vessels turned greenish. Not just copper vessels. I have seen my mother use tamarind juice and lemon juice mixed in water to clean the anklets, the silver anklets that girls, women use. Pile. I hope you have also seen. If you try to clean it with water, it will not clean properly. But if you clean it with this lemon or tamarind, the cleaning is faster. Now we know what is that green substance or what is that black substance. That green substance in case of copper is copper carbonate. The black substance in case of silver is silver sulfide. Now these compounds, they are basic, they are salts and they are basic salts. Lemon, tamarind, taste kaisa hota hai, ekdam chatpata hota hai na. And we studied last year, acids are sour in taste, khatte hota hai. So these lemon and tamarind and other things, they have acids in them. So this acid of lemon tamarind reacts with the basic salts and helps clean easily. That is why we use lemon or tamarind. We can use actual acid also, but it will be dangerous for us. So the naturally available acid in lemon juice and tamarind juice is used for cleaning vessels and ornaments. Number 6, we have answered. Number 7, we have answered. Number 8, we have completed the diagrams. Number 10, we have completed. Number 11, we have completed. Number 9A, aluminium coming in contact with air. We know what is happening. Aluminium will come in contact with air to form aluminium oxide, Al2O3. All we have to do is write the reaction. I'll help you do that. So we have aluminium, which is Al. In oxygen, in air, we will have oxygen. So whenever we are writing a chemical reaction, we are dealing with molecules, so O2. And we know when we study about corrosion of aluminium, we know that it produces aluminium oxide. Now we need to balance it. We need to balance this. Now oxygen is 2 here and oxygen is 3 here. The only way to balance would be to put a 3 here and to put a 2 here. Now 6 oxygen on the left hand side, 6 oxygen on the right hand side. Now there are 4 aluminium on the right hand side. So we will just write a 4 in front of aluminium to balance the chemical equation. So this is what happens. This is the chemical reaction when aluminium comes in contact with air. So these three questions, question 1A, 5A, 9A, will be our homework, which we will complete tonight and share. This completes the chapter number 8 in Science 1, which is metallurgy.